Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu visits troops situated at the border with Gaza on Friday. His visit comes as the Israeli military continued its ground operation in the enclave. There, he told Israel's military he was focused on eliminating Hamas and thanked them for their service.
You are doing a great job. You are providing a screen of fire for our forces. We are moving forward there. We do not stop until the task is completed. The mission is divided into two. Deterrence in the north, and some of you were there. And the decision in the south. The decision is the elimination of Hamas. We are not going back to the situation we were in. And with God's help and with your help, this is what will be.
Netanyahu also vowing to improve the lives of communities living near the border with the Gaza Strip. These communities were among those attacked by Hamas militants on October 7, resulting in the loss of over 8,000 lives. According to local media, the council in charge of planning and building approved the plan to construct a community roughly 7 kilometers from the border last week.
The government will return these communities in a better position than they were before. Restore, build, grow. First of all, to restore security, to make sure that there is no Hamas and that Hamas does not return, but also to make sure that there will be a better life for them in the future.
Israel military says more than 100,000 residents of the Gaza Strip have fled southward in the last 2 days. This comes after Israel told the 1.1 million people in northern Gaza to evacuate their homes immediately as part of its efforts to ramp up retaliation against Hamas.
This is happening in an organized manner for the population living in Gaza in a way that does not interfere with the fighting. It improves our situation. It allows us to battle the terrorists. The second part is the humanitarian part that comes from Egypt by way of Egypt and the United States and other donor nations in the Arab world. They're providing food, providing medicine, tents, establishing field hospitals.
The country's military adds efforts are underway to release those who have been taken hostage by Hamas, but it admits such efforts may take time. The Israeli military bombs 4 hospitals in Gaza, including the enclave's main and largest medical complex. Palestinian authorities say Gaza's Al-Shifa hospital was hit by missiles Friday. Thousands had been seeking refuge in that hospital. Israel has claimed Hamas militants have hidden command centers and tunnels beneath Al-Shifa, allegations which Hamas denies. Palestine's Red Crescent Society told the United Nations hospitals in Gaza have become major Israeli targets. The relentless air campaign by Israel has killed more than 11,000 people in Gaza, with hospitals overflowing with patients and operating with little medical supplies, clean water, and fuel. A child is killed every 10 minutes in the Gaza Strip. World Health Organization Director General Tedros Ghebreyesus made this grim remark in a meeting with the United Nations Security Council Friday. He adds, half of Gaza's 36 hospitals and 2/3 of its primary healthcare centers were not functioning, and those that were operating were way beyond their capacities. Since the war erupted, the WHO has verified more than 250 attacks on healthcare in Gaza and the West Bank, while there have been 25 attacks on healthcare in Israel.
Hospital corridors crammed with the injured, the sick, the dying. Morgues overflowing, surgery without anesthesia, tens of thousands of displaced people sheltering at hospitals, families crammed into overcrowded schools desperate for food and water. 1.5 million people have been displaced and are looking for shelter anywhere they can find it, but nowhere. And no one is safe. Nowhere and no one is safe. As more and more people move to a smaller and smaller space, overcrowding is increasing the risks of outbreaks of diarrheal and respiratory disease and skin infections.
Meanwhile, Israel's UN ambassador Gilad Erdan says a task force has been formed to set up hospitals in southern Gaza.
Israel is in advanced talks with the United Arab Emirates, with the ICRC, and with other European countries regarding the establishment of field hospitals and floating hospital ships. Israel facilitated the Jordanian airdrop of medical aid to hospitals in northern Gaza. Thousands of tons of medical equipment and supplies have already entered Gaza.
Washington's top diplomat issues his strongest condemnation over civilian killings in Gaza. During his visit in New Delhi Friday, State Secretary Antony Blinken said far too many Palestinians have been killed and more have suffered amid the spiraling violence between Israel and Hamas. He also welcomed the daily military pauses in Gaza, but he asserts more needs to be done to protect civilians. Humanitarian groups insist there is an immediate need for a ceasefire in the Israel-Hamas war and not just daily four-hour pauses. In this report, Zen Hernandez talks to one of the Filipino medical coordinators for Doctors Without Borders, who was among the first foreign nationals to evacuate the war-torn Gaza Strip.
Darwin Diaz, a Filipino medical coordinator for MedSan Sun Frontier, or Doctors Without Borders, was among the first foreign nationals to leave the Gaza Strip on November 2. He has since safely returned to the Philippines, but his mind remains on Gaza. As a medical and humanitarian worker for 10 years, Darwin had experienced missions in conflict areas like Sudan and Afghanistan. But for him, the situation in Gaza is most devastating.
Yesterday, nakakuha ko ng balita that one of a friend of mine there, namatay, including the whole family. In Afghanistan, it's soldiers against soldiers, Taliban against the government soldiers. But in Gaza, it's them bombarding everything, hospitals, civilians, ambulances.
Darwin has worked in Gaza for 2 years, but was caught in the latest conflict for 25 days. He has already resigned to the possibility that he can die from either the intense bombardment or lack of food and water. And yet, he continued to lead coordination efforts for medical supplies to hospitals. The need for medicine was so huge that the Doctors Without Borders pharmacy supplies, good for 9 months, only lasted a week. Darwin is thankful, however, for Palestinian staff who did not only man hospitals 24/7, but also took care of him and other expats.
Tarek, Tahir, Ibrahim, Jimmy, Sharkawi, Muhammad, if not because of them, probably we are dead. They are the ones going to the market for 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, just for them to look for water, buy for water and food for us. The Palestinians, Gazans, they are normally kind and they are selfless. So inuuna muna ang ibang tao before ang kanilang sarili. This is how I know them 2 years ago and up to now.
After over a month of aerial bombardment and ground assaults, 10,812 lives have now been lost in Gaza, with nearly half being children. The compounds of three hospitals in Gaza have been also hit by Israeli airstrikes, including a children's hospital. The White House announced that Israel has agreed to a four-hour daily pause to allow civilians to escape and send up to 150 humanitarian aid trucks daily. But for Doctors Without Borders, a ceasefire is what Gaza needs, especially after one of its own personnel was recently killed along with family members.
Our teams still working in Gaza are exhausted and terrified. Our staff tell us that pregnant women can't get to hospitals to deliver. People are stuck under the rubble of shelled-out buildings. Children are having limbs amputated on while lying on the floor. The bombing, the all-out assault, needs to stop now.
Israel remains defiant to calls for a ceasefire and showed videos of a humanitarian corridor that it opened for civilians, reiterating that its war is against Hamas and not Gaza. Darwin, meanwhile, is willing to return to Gaza despite his harrowing experience.
Gaza is bleeding before our eyes, and yet the world is doing nothing. If HQ would ask me to go back in a jiffy, no second thought. Gaza for me is home.
Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
42 more Filipinos have arrived in the Egyptian capital of Cairo after successfully leaving the war-torn Gaza Strip. There they are expected to receive assistance from Philippine authorities. Over 50 Filipinos were able to cross into Egypt, but some of them opted to return to the besieged enclave for their Palestinian family members who were denied entry into Egypt via the Rafah border. The Philippine embassy in the country vows to ramp up repatriation efforts for the safe return of the Filipinos.
I welcome you to Egypt, all of you Filipinos and families and Palestinian and spouses. My team in Rafah, led by Vice Consul Kapati, was there together with his team over there. I was in Rafah the other day for the first group, but I came with the first bus. If you have any medical issues, please inform us so that we can arrange a visit for you to the hospital.
Meanwhile, some 34 Filipinos and one Palestinian spouse from Gaza are back home in Manila Friday. Dozens of Filipinos remain trapped in the enclave over a month into the war. President Joe Biden set to meet Indonesian President Joko Widodo at the White House Monday in a meeting that aims to upgrade U.S. diplomatic ties with a key Indo-Pacific partner. However, the war in Gaza made the scheduled meeting between Israel's staunchest supporter and the leader of the country with the largest Muslim population more complicated. The details in this report.
Indonesian cities have erupted in pro-Palestinian rallies since the October 7 Hamas attack, and emotions are strong.
What Hamas and the Palestinian people did against the invaders, Israel, was their way of fighting to achieve their independence. There's nothing wrong, because that is also what the heroes of the Indonesian nation did when they fought to achieve independence.
That passion will be on Indonesian President Joko Widodo's mind as he meets President Joe Biden at the White House Monday.
Not a single Indonesian president has dared not to defend Palestine. Our founding fathers have laid the foundation of our foreign policy: non-aligned, free and active, defend the oppressed.
The two sides have a large gap to bridge, particularly on a ceasefire in Gaza, but are keen to maintain good relations. Monday's meeting was arranged after Biden skipped the ASEAN summit hosted by Indonesia in September, sending Vice President Kamala Harris in his place and going to Vietnam instead. The leaders last met at the G20 summit in India this year. They are expected to upgrade bilateral ties to a comprehensive strategic partnership, a status Jakarta already shares with Beijing.
The leaders will explore opportunities to enhance cooperation on the clean energy transition, advance economic prosperity, bolster regional peace and stability, and reinforce our people-to-people ties. The two leaders will also coordinate on efforts to reinforce ASEAN centrality and uphold international law and promote a free and open Indo-Pacific.
A key goal for Indonesia, a limited free trade agreement on critical minerals that will allow Indonesian nickel used in electric vehicle batteries to qualify for tax incentives under the 2022 U.S. Inflation Reduction Act. Indonesia has the world's largest nickel reserves, which it mines and refines largely with Chinese financing.
The U.S. is eager to invest in this area, especially because I think, through the lens of China competition, making sure that the nickel industry in Indonesia is not completely dominated there would be a crucial strategic interest.
Some American lawmakers are against the deal due to heavy Chinese investment, labor and environmental concerns in the Indonesian nickel industry. Patsy Widakuswara, VOA News, Washington.
The United Nations warns violence against civilians in Sudan is, quote, verging on pure evil. The top UN aid official in Sudan said the humanitarian crisis is worsening and ethnic violence is escalating in the western region of Darfur. In April, a war erupted between the Sudanese army and paramilitary forces over the planned transition from military rule to civilian democracy.
We keep saying that the situation is horrific and grim. But frankly, we are running out of words to describe the horror of what is happening in Sudan. We continue to receive unrelenting and appalling reports of sexual and gender-based violence, enforced disappearance, arbitrary detentions, and grave violations of human and children's rights. As the fighting continues to rage, over half of the population, 25 million people, require assistance and protection. More than 6 million people have fled their homes and are displaced inside Sudan or in neighboring countries. They are not just numbers. They are individuals whose lives have been uprooted and changed forever.
U.S. warns China anew against providing aid to Russia in its war against Ukraine. Washington's Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen raised the issue during her bilateral talks with Chinese counterpart Vice Premier Heiling Feng in San Francisco. Yellen says the U.S. government acquired evidence that Chinese firms might be providing military equipment to Russia despite Western sanctions.
We do see evidence that there are Chinese firms, and I'm certainly not saying with the knowledge of the Chinese government, but some Chinese private firms that may be aiding in the flow of this equipment and material to Russia, as well as some financial institutions that could be involved in facilitating that flow. So I stressed in our conversations that it's critical to us that companies not provide material support for Russia's defense industrial sector, and that we were prepared to put in place further sanctions. My hope is that this understanding will serve as a foundation for future mutually beneficial progress.
The meeting comes ahead of next week's APEC summit, where the highly anticipated meeting between U.S. President Joe Biden and Chinese President Xi Jinping is expected to happen. The two giant economies have been moving to improve relations, which have soured over geopolitical issues. Days of heavy rains trigger flooding in northern France. Local rivers overflowed, inundating houses and fields. Residents were forced to evacuate, with some needing to be airlifted to safety. More than 100 towns are on red alert, and some 200 schools in the region have been shut. Locals call the situation there catastrophic. There's also massive flooding in poultry farms, killing chickens.